In this video, I'll show you if the 996 Turbo market already bottomed out, how sensitive they are to mileage, and which cars sell for a premium. What's up YouTube, and welcome to a new video. So the 996 Turbo starts to get a little bit of a cult status, and that is visible in the market. Many of you did then also request an analysis for this market, and among those were Randy and Pete. Now if you also want to request a video, that's possible. Simply comment the name of the car for which you would like to see an analysis down below in the comment section. Once enough people request a certain car, I will make a video about it. Now then, we will start to look at the 996 Turbo market, and we will do that with a few steps. First, we will place the 996 Turbo in the context of the full turbo market. We can then namely see where it sits on the market depreciation curve. After that, we will zoom into the 996 Turbo and have a look at the depreciation per year and depreciation per 1000 miles driven. For reasons which I will explain later, we stick then with the depreciation per 1000 miles and figure out which cars demand a premium in today's market. At the end of this video, I will show you then how the rates for the 996 Turbo compare to all of the other cars which I've analyzed on this channel. Now let's start with the first step, and that was having a look to the larger turbo market. And that market is appearing right over here, where you can see that we've model year on the horizontal axis and price on the vertical axis. Each car is represented by a bubble, and the blue solid line going through the graph displays the depreciation curve. If we look to this graph, then we can see that all the modern turbo generations are included, with exception of the new 992. In total, there are 813 cars for sale, and you're most likely to pay around $124,000 for a turbo. Now, if we look to the depreciation curve, then we can see that it is very smooth and that it follows a natural pattern. The depreciation is very high in the first year and then slowly starts to decrease. And especially for the cars which are around 10 years old, we can see a clear flattening in the curve. Now we know that this graph displays several 911 generations, so let's identify those with a color. Now you can see namely that from the 997.1 generation onwards, the curve is more or less flat. Now if we shift our focus then to the 996, then we can see that they are around $18,000 cheaper than the 997.1. And that is even though that the curve is almost flat for the 997.1. And the reason for that is that the new generations typically go for a premium compared to the older ones, at least when there are major differences between the generations. You can see, for example, the same in the McLaren market with the 650S and the 12C. Now let's start to focus on the 996 market, because as you can see, there are some strange things going on over there. Before we do that, however, please remember to support the channel by smashing that like button. Now then, the 996 market. That should be appearing right now on your screen, and you can see that we only have the 996s there. Let's first cover some general numbers. There are 103 cars for sale, and they tend to cost you around $52,000. And for this amount, you get a car with around 40,000 miles. Also, you're most likely to get a black or a silver one, because those two colors are the most popular. And in general, the rule is, the brighter the color, the rarer the car. If we look then at the price points, then we can see that prices start at around $30,000 and go up till around $120,000. You can, however, see immediately that there are only a few cars which are priced at the top end. But there's a good reason for it, and I will come back to it later in the video. Now, if we look to the depreciation curve, then we can see that there actually isn't any depreciation. You can see that the curve is slightly downward sloping, but that this is the result of the outliers in model year 2005. If we were to remove those, the line would in essence be flat. And this is something which you can also observe by having a look to the black axes in the graph. These namely show the most occurring price point per model year and don't really deviate a lot between the model years. Now the fact that there's no depreciation anymore for these cars fits of course with the larger market picture, where we saw that from the 997.1 generation onwards, the market's depreciation starts to flatten. And that of course also means that the model year is not really important anymore for the price of a 996 Turbo. It is even so that the correlation between model year and price is only 0.3, and that is the lowest I've seen on this channel. And in general, when cars reach this point where model year is no longer relevant to the price of a car, there come other factors into play. And out of those, mileage is key. We are therefore going to dissect the 996 Turbo market with the depreciation per 1000 miles graphs. That will namely allow us to see which cars go for a premium and why. And the depreciation per 1000 miles graph is appearing right over here, where you can see that we have now the mileage on the horizontal axis and the price still on the vertical axis. If we have a look at this graph, then you can see that you can choose from a large variety of mileages. There are cars which probably still smell like a new car and cars which have well over 100,000 miles driven. Now, if we disregard the depreciation curve for a moment and just focus on the mileages and the prices, then we see why the few outlier cars in model year 2005 were priced so far above the rest of the market. The first reason for this is that they have an extremely low mileage of below 20,000 miles. However, you can see that there are other cars which also have a low mileage, but that they are priced a lot lower. And I will come back to this later. Now, if we focus then on the depreciation, then we can see that on average, a 996 Turbo loses $395 per 1,000 miles driven. And this number is just as for the normal 996, extremely low. You can see though from the shape of the curve that the height of this number depends a lot on the mileage which a car already has. It is, for example, higher for the cars under 40,000 miles and lower for the ones over 40,000 miles. Also, note that the shaded area is very large for the cars over 80,000 miles. And this signals that there's uncertainty in the prices at that level. Now, if we take a step back then we can see that even though we are looking to the miles versus price relationship, there is still a lot of price variation going on. And with that, I mean the price variation which we can't explain with the differences in mileages. You can, for example, get a 996 Turbo with 20,000 miles for around $50,000, but you can also pay almost double for a car with the same mileage. And in the beginning of the video, we already saw that model year is not really relevant for the price anymore. So that of course means that there are other factors, and I can reveal that two of them are key. So let's split the market. The first one is of course the transmission type. You can see that in blue we have now the manual cars and in orange the automatic ones. And you can see that there are 77 manuals for sale and 30 automatic cars. Now, for any given mileage, the manuals tend to be $5,400 more expensive than the automatic ones. So the manuals clearly go for a premium. You can see though that this goes especially for the low mileage examples, as the difference fades away when you move to the right on the mileage axis. You however also need to account for the second factor over here, and that is the type of turbo. You can namely look at the basic one, the one with the X50 package, or the S version. That market split is now appearing on your screen. You can see the S version and the ones with the X50 package are the most rare. There are namely only 10 of each for sale. They also go for a premium compared to the base version. An S will cost you an average $29,000 more, and one with the X50 package will cost you an average $14,000 more. And also here we can see that this premium decreases rapidly when you add mileage. It is even so that it seems to disappear completely between 80 and 100,000 miles. Now, it is also important to point out here that there are large shaded areas for the X50 and the S versions. And this shows that there's a lot of uncertainty in the price, resulting from the small market. So let's now combine everything what we have seen, meaning the mileage, the transmission type, and the turbo type. That will namely give us a nice overview of the market, where a large proportion of the price variation is explained. So let's see what we end up with. You can see now that the automatic base versions of the turbo are priced the lowest, followed by the manual base versions. Then we have the automatic S version and the automatic X50 version. All the way to the top you will find in the manual S's and the manual X50s. So, for each version, the base, the X50, and the S, the manuals go for a premium compared to the automatic cars. You can see however that for some market splits, such as for example for the automatic S, there are very few data points. And that of course means that you need to interpret this ranking and these numbers over here with some care. Now then, before we close this video, I still want to show you one more thing, and that is how the 996 Turbo ranks on the depreciation leaderboard. That leaderboard namely contains all of the rates for all of the cars which I've analyzed on this channel, and will therefore show us if the ones for the 996 Turbo are actually high or low. And because the turbo prices are dominated by the mileage, we will have a look to the depreciation per 1,000 miles driven leaderboard. That is now appearing on your screen, and you can see that we have the different cars on the horizontal axis and the relative rate on the vertical axis. Now, with a rate of -0.5%, the 996 Turbo is less sensitive to mileage than the 997. It is however more sensitive to mileage than the normal 996. However, as you can see from the height of the bars, there's not much in it. Finally then, you can also see that the 996 Turbo is, for example, slightly more sensitive to mileage than a Ferrari 360. And that car is even 2 years older. And with that being said, Let's wrap up this video and conclude. I think it's fair to say that just as the normal 996 market, the 996 Turbo market bottomed out. Now, I didn't track the prices over time for the US market, but I did so for the European one. And in Europe, the 996 Turbo prices actually went up. And this goes especially for the low mileage examples. In fact, the premiums over here for some cars are a little bit crazy in my opinion. Now, because I don't have the same data for the US market, it is of course difficult to conclude that the same is happening or will be happening. The US market does, however, show the same characteristics. Low mileage cars go for an insane premium, and this is further complemented by the transmission type and the model type. Now, there are of course some other factors which come into play here, such as the maintenance history, the number of owners, and the overall condition of the car. Those are though very difficult to capture in the data. Now, if you enjoyed this video, but you would have liked to see this analysis for a different car, then I recommend that you go to my channel. Over there you will find many different analyses, such as ones for Ferraris, other Porsches, and McLarens. Now, if you can't find the car you're looking for, remember to comment it down below in the comment section, and maybe it will feature next week. I namely upload a new analysis every Saturday. As always, a huge thank you for watching, and I hope to see you next week.